Hello, Internet. I'm here again with another RPG game video, and today I want to make a greenhouse, garden, something like that. Something where you will plant plants, they'll take a while to grow, and at the end of growing you can say, great, I want to harvest it or whatever. And maybe we'll add some features like pulling up plants or things like that. We'll see how far we get. So let's jump into it before I run out of time just rambling about what we're going to do. So we're going to want a new page. Right now all we have is your house that you can go to. I think in other videos I've added like a store or something, so if you've seen those, this will look pretty familiar. We're going to add a new page where you can check out your garden. And let's go with the name garden, right? Whatever you want to call it, though. I'm going to go with the name garden. You can call it whatever you want. So to make a new page, we have this pages folder in the project. Let me just minimize this. We've got as much screen space as possible here, at least up and down wise. I'd like to keep these visible so we can go back and forth. But let's make a page, and you'll see that there is an option for razor page. You can do that. That adds some other stuff I don't tend to like. And what the options are here a little bit depends on whether you're using Visual Studio, Visual Studio Code, or Writer. I tend to go with Blazor Component, but feel free to try out the other options available to you and just, you know, see what provides the better starting point for you. But pages are components like any other. They just happen to have some extra little data, which we'll get to in a sec. So let's call it garden. And right, what is that extra data I was talking about? We can look at another page to see an example. So it needs to know what is the URL. And it needs to know, are you allowed to be here, right? So this authorize attribute says you've got to be logged in order to access this page. If you don't do that, like on the login page, then anyone can access it. And for some pages, like the login page, that's exactly what you want, right? You shouldn't have to be logged in to use a login page. That would be unfortunate. But for your house or for your garden, we'll want to do that. This page title thing also sets the page title up here. So you can see it says RPG game, my house. That's what's shown in the title of the browser there. And then this part is what we see on page. So that's house. So let's copy all this stuff. That looks pretty useful. And we'll throw that into garden here. And I don't know why I made that noise. And we'll rename this garden, and we can do something similar. We'll say it's whoever's name it is, garden. But to get the player, so you can see the IDE is trying to help here. I've kind of pointed out this feature before. So it's saying, hey, I don't have something called player, but I do know where I can find one. There is this, and it's telling us, there is this table, player table. Do you want me to go and get that for you? In this case, that would be incorrect. We don't want, like, a reference to the whole player table. This player variable here actually references, if we go back to my house and see, the current player. So if we want to get the current player, we will do this instead. So the IDE autocomplete feature there isn't quite what we want. But while we're here, let's get some other things. We're going to want, and we don't have them yet, we'll do this in a sec, but we're going to want to do something similar where we list all the things you have, but instead of pets, we're going to list your plants. But really, the concept is the same. We're going to want to load them up. We're going to need a database connection, which is what this does here. And then we're going to pull them in where the owner is the current player, right? All this stuff is super, super similar to what we're going to want. So here's the database factory. I'll grab that too. Again, the current player, so we can show the title and get the ones owned by the player. So I'm going to copy all this and throw it into the garden. And for any kind of page, right? Well, when you start making all these features, like, I don't know, poppy seed pets, I might as well talk about the web game I actually run. It has a lot of features that it's really the same concept. You know, here's your fireplace. Here's all the stuff in your fireplace. Here's your greenhouse, all the stuff in your greenhouse. Here's, I'm trying to remember the other add-ons at the top of my head. There's a portal that's got a little mini board game inside. Okay, let's load up all the stuff you have, all the dice you've got and all these things. So a lot of pages that you make, if you kind of go that route of different things players can own, are going to be very similar to this. Of, I need a database, I need a current player, I need to get a list of the things, and right, and that's how the page works. So this kind of code we're going to end up probably using a lot. You might as well. So for this, we've got right the red with the red text, but it's got sometimes that white underline that tells us that the IDE knows how to resolve the issue, so I'm going to ask it to. There's different keyboard shortcuts here. For writer, it says Alt Enter, okay. Whoops. And then it grabs them. So what has it done? It's put all these using statements up top. It said, where do I find this DB context factory? Oh, that comes from Microsoft Entity Framework. That's our database accessing library that we're using by Microsoft. It knows how to pull that in. says, oh, where do I find current player? That's some RPG game services. You can see that here, current player. So again, we're going to rely on the IDE features to write all the silly code for us, this kind of boilerplate stuff. And down here, though, where we pull in characters, that's not what we're going to do here. So again, if you've been watching the series for a while, it used to be called Pets because it was only for a pet game, quote unquote. But I've just kind of genericized some of the names to be a little more appropriate for different kinds of games you might want to make with this thing, because it doesn't just have to be pet games. So characters is this guy. He's a character or a pet. And again, that's not what we want to pull in. We want to pull in all of your plants. So let's go and do some things here, even though they don't exist. So plant doesn't exist, right? We haven't told the code what a plant is, so we're not going to have that. And I don't know, I guess we call this my plants, and then we'll use that down here, just doing a copy paste. And then we would pull that from a database table called plants. But again, we haven't defined any of these things yet, so it's not going to know how to pull up plants. Also, we're not telling it how to show them. That should all go in here. So let's start filling in some of those things. We're going to want, similar to, so here's the database viewer. I should probably explain what I'm jumping into. Heidi SQL, I've talked about it in previous videos. It's an open source database thing. You can use it to view your database, which here it is. It's just a file. So you can tell this thing, hey, open a file, point it at RPG game database, and you can browse the whole database. So here we've got the characters, which we were just talking about. Here's all the data. Here's my little guy, Roy. Yep, Roy, and this graphic is called Little Guy, so we can see that. Yep, little guy Roy, perfect. Here's a list of players, here's who I'm logged in as, bb.com. We want a plants table, right? And if you've been watching this series for a while, you've seen me do this a million times, so I'm not going to dwell too much on it, but we're going to make a database table using the entity framework code-first approach. So if you want to know more about it, you can Google for that. Microsoft has tons of documentation on it. I'm sure you can find countless videos on the subject. For this video, I'll just kind of go through it and not explain too much what I'm doing. But we'll explain a little bit. We want a plant table. And in RPG game, you don't need to. There's other ways to do it. But for convenience, tell it, hey, it's an RPG game table. That will fill in some of the details for you automatically. And this is the part I always forget. Over in the RPG game database, we have to tell it, we have to list out all the things that are actually going to show up in the database and what they're called. So there will be a DB set of plants. Now we made this plant thing, and the table will be called plants. And just by convention, and again, you'll see anyone using Entity Framework, almost anyone, they're going to be following this convention. The class name is single, right? We have one plant, this will represent one character, and it's going to live in the table called characters or plants with a plural. So singular name for your class name, plural name for your table name. And before we actually tell it to put the plants table in the database over here, let's go ahead and define what the properties of plant will be. So we will have a owner ID similar to the character. So character, yep, we do a similar thing here. So for pets, for some reason, or characters, I should say, I decided maybe they don't have like an owner at the moment. I was thinking maybe there could be like some pool that you recruit from or something. They're not owned by anyone, or who knows? I don't know. For some reason, I decided to say maybe there isn't one, right? That's what this question mark means. But for plants, I'm going to say we're definitely going to have them, so we won't make, this one optional. No owner ID. And then this is for convenience. Oops, it's got to be a player. And this also helps Entity Framework. I've mentioned before that this is mainly a convenience for the developer. You could leave it out. If you do leave it out, you'd have to do some other configuration. By including it here and saying it's optional for, you need to do this, but again, you can kind of Google more about this, or you've seen previous videos, ask ChatGPT. But this also tells Entity Framework that, hey, owner ID refers to one of the players and not something else. Like maybe it's owned by a character. It doesn't know, right? Maybe your little guys own plants. But no. It's a player that represents the owner. And by naming these things the same, it's able to figure that out and set up the relationships properly in the database. So anyway, let's also make a date time of when it was planted. And we really should use a date time offset. Have I done that in other places? Let me see. Yeah, I sure have. Okay, so there's date time in C#. There's also date time offset. Daytime offset is considered better practice for like kind of weirdish technical reasons. But as a general rule of thumb, you want to keep times in your database, not in any particular time zone. You know, oh, we're on the East Coast, or I'm in the West Coast, or whatever, I'm in Australia. Use UTC. Just use UTC to store everything. And then when you want to show players your time, you can convert to their local time after the fact. But to keep things sane, right, don't try and keep things in each player's time zone. That's going to start to get confusing. Just keep everything in UTC. And this is like almost any programmer will tell you, yes. And datetime offset helps you do that kind of a little better. I don't know. It's kind of weird. You can Google about datetime versus datetime offset as well, or ask ChatGPT. It's a whole thing. But if you don't want to get into it, just know that datetime offset is the generally preferred thing to keep. So this is going to be used for when the planet was planted on. And I'm going to be nice to the developer. And here's where we want to use UTC now. Not just now, but UTC now. And that way, by doing this, it will be provided, you know, by default. When at you as a developer, when you're saying, I want to make a new plant, you won't have to fill in the planted on date. It's just going to always be the current date. We do also want, for our future selves, to require that we set an owner ID. That'll prevent us from making a new plant without setting that property. The compiler will complain and say, no, you forgot. You have to do this. So that's just to protect ourselves in the future. If something's required, let the language know it's required. I think something else we want to know is the kind of plant. Maybe that's too much detail for this video, but, you know, maybe you've got orange trees and banana trees and money trees, and I don't know what you're going to make. So maybe you would have some sort of, you know, name of the plant or type of plant, which you could do as an enum thing. Maybe I'll just do that to demonstrate. So let's make like a plant type, which isn't such a, you know, there's no such thing yet. This should also be required. And then what's plant type? Well, we'll tell it.
Yeah.
Plant type. And we can decide what is the type of plant. And there's multiple ways you could do this. Maybe the plant type is a whole other table. Maybe it's just a number. I don't know. But an enum is one way to do it. And better than just using a number or a string, because it forces you to use the right thing, right? Like we said, string type. What if you accidentally typoed apple and only put one P or something like that? You would never know. But if we do enums and we say apple, you cannot do, right? If you do a typo, the IDE won't even let me. It's being too smart. Right, it's going to say no, you can't do that. I'm not going to build. You have an error. Right, so enums are a good way to protect us from ourselves. Again, just a recurring theme. Protect yourself from your future self from yourself. From itself. I don't know. Time travel. Confusing. So yeah, let's make an apple tree and a money tree as two examples. Why not? And this will now be stored in the database as well. So let's go ahead and put this in the database. I think I've already got a command prompt open. Nope, that's somewhere else. Don't worry about it. So we'll go here, RpgGame specifically. So we've got RpgGame that's got the solution, which you've probably opened, that's got all this stuff, but we need to go into RpgGame within that. We will open up a new console here. And by the way, you might have to hold down like, was it Control or Alt? I was forget, Shift? Is it Shift? It's Shift. Some, if you haven't installed PowerShell 7 yourself, then you hold down Shift and then you have open PowerShell window here. That's another way to get there. I honestly don't know why I've installed PowerShell, the newest, fanciest thing, because I don't really use its features, but whatever. All right, so now we have to tell, and again, I've covered this before in other videos and Google about this, we need to tell any framework that we would like to make this new migration. So add migration. We're doing just the little steps we need to get this plant table actually in the database, because right now all we've done is written some code. So we'll say, sorry, and it's migrations add, and we'll say add plants, any human readable name you like. And it's going to build, and this is something else I always forget to do. Can't run this at the same time. Succeeded, all right. And then we're going to double check that our migration looks good, didn't do anything surprising. It says creates a table called plants, make some sort of foreign key, the owner is the player. Yep, that all looks right. An index, sure. Thing. If these things make sense to you, great. If they don't make sense, just kind of look that you don't at least see anything like, I don't know, character, right? It's like, oh, why does it say owner's going to characters, right? Like we talked about, maybe you didn't properly do things, and it got confused and hooked things to the wrong table or something, so we'll just look through and make sure everything looks good. This all looks good. This down migration is also a useful place to see, because the undoing operation is pretty clear too. It's like, right, if we undid this migration, what would happen? It would drop plants, that's it. That makes sense, because all it should have done was add plants, right? So this is also just another quick way to verify. So that is it. Now when we run the game, it will also run this migration, which adds the table, and then we should see the table over here. That's fun. What's that? The following routes are ambiguous. Oh no, I didn't update the URL. Okay, so we've confused the game a little bit. So if we go back to the garden page, I left this page as being slash my house. And sorry, let's look at that error again. Let's not, I kind of skipped through it without explaining. So I said this, failed to compare two elements in the array. Okay, the following routes are ambiguous. My house in my house and my house in garden. So it's telling us we've used the same URL twice. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have skipped over that so quickly the first time. Is it still showing us that here? Maybe if I restart, we'll get the full page message. Here we go, yeah. So invalid operation, sure. The following routes are ambiguous. My house. So okay, so we know what we need to do. This needs to be a different URL. We can't have the same URL for, whoops, for two pages. All right. But we should already, which is what we're looking for. Daily rewards collected. How did that get back in here? That's from a previous video. Actually, that is kind of funny, and it says it's favorited. Okay. Anyway, we've got our plants. Let's not worry about that. So the previous video, I did daily rewards. Apparently, I've probably just left it behind. So anyway, ignore that. If you've seen the previous video, it makes sense. But we have our plants table. Wonderful. They're all going to have an owner ID. Makes sense when they were planted on in the type. All right. Now we would actually like the player, we would like to let the player plant some plants. So let's do that too. This code, by the way, right, is all working now, right? Before we had red, because it didn't know what plants were a plant, but we went and filled all this in. So we can go to the garden. We're going to need a link to it, because I'm a silly thing. This is a feature that I need to add to RpgGame. Future video. Okay, we don't have a link to get to our garden. That's a problem. Maybe we'd like to add one up here. Let's go ahead and do that. Links to get back to, like, my house, garden. We can just put some extra links up here. Maybe I'll make a video about doing, like, a whole drop-down menu or something else like that. But for now, so if we go to, there is a layout. Oh my goodness, I haven't touched this in a while. Here we go, layout, nav menu. So we either have hello stranger or hello, I know who you are. That's good. So let's add some links here. Let's add, let me just copy these. And we'll let you go to my house and the garden. We'll say, I don't know, house, garden, and if we say class equals button, it's going to look like a button, which is probably not what we want here, so I'll delete that. Oh, and by the way, so if you hold down Alt and click and drag, you can select rectangles of text, which can be occasionally useful. Like right now, I'm just going to delete all this at once. Delete. That's a fun little tip, and that works in most IDEs. They do that now. Let's see if the apply works. Yeah, it worked. All right, so these don't look that great with the purple, but let me do something else. Let's do a little bit of styling. You don't do CSS very often. So let's do, this will be an unordered list, and I'm just using that because this is conceptually a list. If you've done HTML a little before, you might be like, that's going to add like bullets and stuff, right? That's not what we want it to look like, right? Like this. This is what an unordered list looks like. Unordered list, sorry. But for HTML, and you know, we've got CSS now, don't worry about the default appearance. You want to go for what is semantically, you know, conceptually correct. What is this? It is a list. And it's not ordered. It doesn't, right? It doesn't really matter how they are. I mean, maybe you could argue it does. I don't know. But it is a list. That's what this thing is. And that'll help for SEO when Google is crawling your site, search engine optimization. It'll help screen readers. It will help you in the future to use these, you know, meaningful attributes. This is a list. That's what this thing conceptually is. And we can make it look like we want with CSS. Don't worry about the default appearance. We'll make it look like what we want. So let's call this, I don't know, say player links. We'll give it some class. And that way in here, we can say, great, player links. We want to display it differently. So it won't be a list anymore. We'll do like, make it a flex. Direction row. And if you don't know CSS, maybe it would be, maybe we shouldn't do flex just because that's, No, you should learn Flex. Flex is great. You go and Google for how to use Flex in CSS. There's tutorials that will show you all about it. There's also Grid, which is related related, and kind of a little more powerful. Historically, it didn't have as much browser support, but by now, don't even worry about Internet Explorer anything, right? We're done with that. So you can use Grid. But Flex is a little more popular because it was widely supported first. So anyway, you'll find tutorials on both. You can also put gaps, so how much space do we want between each element? And I think we need to say like list style none, and I don't remember, we might need to remove margins, because again, there's this default styling for a list that does all that kind of stuff. Let's restart the app, see what that looks like. Looks like I didn't have the apply button available there. All right, so we got house, garden, cool, but we have still got it on a new line, which we don't like. I guess we could do something else. So we've got this div. I mean, another way we can do that is make it all via flex. Yeah, I guess we'll do that. So I'll wrap all this up in a div, which could be useful for doing other layout later. And this can go in a div. And div, by the way, if you don't know a ton of HTML, it's kind of a generic container, like, hey, I contain stuff. Actually, here, let's do this. So we've already got a button. And then here's a button. Okay, so these are all the elements. Oops, somehow I deleted the div part. The IDE was trying to be smart. Okay, so let's say this is like you're logged in nav. Let's do something slightly different here. So we'll say that this should go right from left to right. We want it to be in a row going across. And we're going to want to make these links look a little different. That was kind of the point. The point of this video was not to mess around with the nav menu, but why not? We've got links to add up here. And again, I'll do a video later that does a whole like drop-down menu or something. All right, but the concept here is these are each kind of representing one cell in this row, this logged in nav. So I'm going to make this be logged in nav. And so we've got flex, blah, blah, blah. We don't need to worry about list style. Margin, but then when we get to the logged in nav list of things, then we will do the same thing. And actually, you know what? I think we'll just do the same thing. It will also be a flex within a flex. That's totally allowed. We're flexing with flexes. All right, so here we go. House, garden. So things aren't lining up quite right, but we can fix that. Also, I think we still have some margin from the unordered list. I'm actually kind of okay with that. And we can do one more thing here, and let's play around in the browser just to test, partly because I always forget the things. So you might notice they're like lined up funny. What's happening is they're all lined up to the top, right? There's some invisible line up here, which they're all kind of pressed up against. But we can fix that. You can say, and I always forget, that's why I'm doing this in the browser right here. We want, it's like align items, or yeah, I think it's align either content or items. See, so middle or center. There we go, and that was it. Okay, align item center. It was the first thing I guessed, which is nice. I've done this enough times, but I always forget. There's so many things like center, or is it center or middle? Is it align items or align content? there's like all these combinations, and it gets confusing in my brain. So anyway, that aligns them all properly. And the other thing I think we could do is make these list items always be white. But hold on, so I did that change here, but this actually isn't going to stick. So align item center, I need to go up here and do line item center. And then here where we have, so we'll say in our logged in nav, in our unordered list, any A tags you find, I want the color to just be white. So I think, do I have, no. Getting confused with other web projects. Don't worry about it. All right, so we'll make them always be white so they'll look a little better. All right, house, garden, we've got some links, perfect. And you could style these better. Maybe there should be icons associated with each one. And if you watch the video on adding, why am I blanking on the name? But I had a whole video on adding this whole icon library. You could probably find a little house icon or a little plant icon. Just throw those in real quick. Or maybe you want to go draw some graphics or whatever. You can spruce this up on your own. Let's make sure that they work at least. That's nice. All right, so that was a lot of funny work to get. And not horrible, at least, navigation links. And again, I'll totally do a video to kind of do like a drop-down menu or something nicer. Dedicate a whole video to that. But we're here to make plants, and we've gotten so distracted. So we can get to the garden page. We see that it works, quote unquote. We have no plants for it to get, but we also haven't even told it how to draw plants. And we also don't have a way to add plants. So let's add all of those things. So let's go back. Close the layout menu. We're done with that. We don't need migrations either. Let's go, and this is going to bug me, and I know it shouldn't be here. Never do that unless you know you've made a horrible mistake. Okay. there shouldn't be that table. I think it was left over there from a previous video. So yeah, if you ever do that and you like on one, like if you just deleted plants like that, it would be very hard to get back. So in general, don't use this tool to make changes to the database. You really want to use the entity framework tools, use migrations to make any changes. Otherwise, things are going to get out of sync and you're going to have a lot of horrible bugs and be confused and get frustrated. So just don't make changes to the tables there. That was literally because I knew it was just left over from the previous video. So anyway, just want to warn you, because again, you'll get yourself in a difficult place. Okay, let's go back to the garden and let's just make a button to add more. We'll make a plant button. So here, let's leave ourselves a to-do. We'll say list all the plants. Oops. To-do, list all the plants. We're not there yet. But let's make a button for ourselves to plant a plant. So, and we made two different kinds of plants. So, you know, if you've done, if you added inventory, which I want to make a video about inventory as well, I have a write-up in the README, the source code of the project, how you might add inventory to the game. But so supposing you have inventory in your game, maybe you want to see like, oh, what are the seeds that we have? You know, do they have an apple seed, tree seed? Do they have a money tree seed? Something like that. I'm just going to, you know, we're working from scratch every video. This is the base game, so we don't have inventory. So I'm just going to make a button, no restrictions. Hey, you can just plant an apple tree. You can just plant a money tree. You can plant whatever you want. So let's do that. So we'll say like plant a or an apple tree. And we'll have plant a money tree. That space is really bothering me. All right, so I have those two buttons. Let's just look at them. They're not gonna do anything yet. See, now the apply didn't work. It worked for that other stuff, but it doesn't wanna work here. Very curious. I really don't understand how that apply thing works and doesn't work. They are improving it. .NET 8 is coming out in November, and they've said that they're improving the hot reload, so it's possible, which is what that feature is called. So maybe we'll, you know, things like that will work a little better in the future. So anyway, plant an apple tree, plant a money tree, great, but of course, clicking on them doesn't do anything. So how do we set up something to happen? We do this on click. And again, how would you know to do that? That's just Blazor. You want to Google for a general Blazor tutorial. You might also know by looking at my house and seeing things like this button, which says on click, do this thing. So we're going to do that here. We'll say on click, I want to, so let's say plant tree. And we have plant types. We can say, I want to do an apple tree. So these two buttons are going to call the same function, which is called plant tree, which I haven't made yet. And actually, I like to, my little click handlers I like to prefix with do, just so when I'm scrolling through functions, I see a function prefix with do and say, and I know, oh, that's a click handler because it says do in the front. I don't know. It's a convention I picked up from this Udemy course forever ago for a totally different framework. So I don't know if it's totally appropriate here, but it helps for me. So, okay, do plant tree apple, do plant tree, we'll do money. And now we need to make this do plant tree function. So let's go ahead and do that. This will be a asynchronous task. That's a good default for any of our functions, as I've mentioned in previous videos, because in the real, when you deploy this for real, you don't know how long a database operation is going to take. Things got to go up in the through cell phone towers and everything. So doing everything async task helps the whole program work a little better. I talk about that more in other videos, and you can also Google about that if you're curious. Why do we use async task in a Blazor application? I'm sure you'll find all sorts of people talking about that. So this function needs to take a plant type, right? Do plant tree takes a plant type. Right now it's a squiggly red underlining because it says, I don't know, it doesn't take anything, but you gave me something. So okay, we need to know the plant type, and we can just find name. Plant type suggested, I think, by GitHub Copilot. Actually, looks like I have that disabled. That'll make the video easier to follow. Honestly, when the AI autocomplete starts throwing up lots of text, sometimes it gets confusing. So anyway, we need to get another database connection and give the player a plant. So let's do that. We can just copy paste that. And then we say db add, and we can just make a new plant right here. Let's make a new plant. And we need to know the owner, and this is helpful. So it says, hey, give me an ID. Actually, don't. This is something I don't think I've talked about before in videos, but don't assign manually an ID to anything. That's going to be figured out by the database, and it'll just get confusing if you try. And it might not even let you, depending on how, I think that's true. I think with the default entity framework setup, it'll even say, no, you're not allowed to. I don't remember. Just don't try. You'll just let it assign the new value. So whoops, what were the other properties we needed here? Is it going to tell me now? No. Okay, but if we hover over, right, why is it squiggly underlined red? Required member, owner must be set, and type must be set. And again, this is why we made them required in the definition of plant. We don't want to forget. We don't want any possibility that we didn't set these properties. Because if we don't say required, C# will just kind of guess the best value it can think of. Not even the best value. It does the zeroest value it can think of. So if it was a number, it's just going to be zero. If you said, oh, this is a string, it's just going to make an empty string. For plant type, it's just going to pick whatever the first plant type is. So we really want to be required to set these things explicitly. So for the owner ID, we will do the player. And I should really make getting the player a little more natural. This is just some RPG game magic you need to know to get the current player. I may someday make this interface a little better. I feel like, I don't know, that is not an intuitive thing to type. So I would like to make that a little better, but for another time. Planted on, we don't set type. Yep, that's what I was looking for. So that'll be the plant type. And that's all we need to do. This will put a new plant in the database. Then we save those changes to the database. We say save all your changes. If we don't do this, it won't do anything. So restart, and now we should have buttons that add plants. That's all it'll do. They're not going to show up, but we'll see them in the database at least, so that'll be good to verify. So that's a garden, plant a money tree, plant an apple tree, and actually you can see some things happening over here. Threw some text up here. So again, we're not seeing anything here. That seems kind of interesting. We left that to do for ourselves. But if we reload the plants table, I'm going to press F5. Yeah, there we go. So here they are. Type 1, type 0. That corresponds to, if we can find the plant type, where is that? Here we go, plant type 0 and 1. That's an important note. So if you ever rearrange the order here, like if you try to keep things in alphabetical order, you will ruin which one is 0 and which one is 1, right? The first one is always 0. And you can explicitly give values, which might be safe to do. This one is 1. But if you don't number them, that's what the numbering is. So I just want to demonstrate. Like, suppose you made orange later, or maybe not orange. Let's do banana. You're like, oh, but B goes before M, right? Well, now all your plants that people planted that were money, which was 1, are now banana. You get yourself in trouble. One way to prevent that will be to explicitly number all these. And then you can do it in any order you want. And now banana is always going to be 2, even though it's before 1. That's one thing you can do. There's also a way that you can tell in any framework, don't store a number, store the name of this thing. For apple, store apple. For banana, store banana. Then you're trading one problem for another, because now if you ever rename one of these, if you're like, oh, actually, my game is silly and I want to call it banana, well, now you've broken everyone who planted the banana. So pick your poison, but yeah, just be aware, be careful with how you're changing things. I should probably just always say, look, assign a number here. So let's do that. We'll leave that alone. You can add banana later on your own, or even banana if you like. Anyway, so we've got plants in our database. Now we'd like to show them to the player. And we also want the plants to take some amount of time to grow. Maybe you would like this to depend on the type of plant, or who knows. For the purposes of this video, I'll just say it always takes, I don't know, 8 hours or something. 8 hours for a plant to grow. So let's go ahead and draw the plants, and we'll do a little progress bar. So up here, list all the plants. I'm not going to go into making a bunch of graphics for these things. That would blow up the length of this video, and oh my goodness, we're already at 30-something minutes. So let's just do a table. I'm just going to do a simple table. If you want to, if you're more graphically inclined, you just want to do the graphics, maybe you want to try using the quote-unquote cards, as I've called them. So if you go to my house, this is a character card with a ribbon. You could make a new card thing, maybe to show a plant graphic here, the name of the plant, and then what its progress is, right? Maybe you want to do that. For this, I'm going to do a table, simple table, and we need to know if we have loaded them. So if we go to my plants, when the page first loads up, there's not going to be anything. It's going to be empty. And then this gets hit. And again, it's asynchronous. We don't know how long this database action is going to take to get all of your plants. It could take half a second. I don't know if you're on a slow connection. So the way we handle that, and we've handled them in my house, is we say, okay, if it's null, then tell them we're still loading. And then when they're not, then we go ahead and display. So let's copy that pattern here. Very common kind of approach to this stuff. So we'll say if my plants are null, we haven't loaded anything. And by the way, that's why we've got this question mark. It means at the start, it is null, it's unassigned, there's nothing there. And if you get rid of that, it's actually going to complain and say, hey, I need some sort of default value. What should the default value be? Well, if it can be null, it knows, oh, I'll just make it null. So the language just assumes, kind of like we were talking about before, if you don't give it a value, it picks the zeroist kind of value that it can easily come up with. So when something can be null, that's kind of your zeroist value is null. I don't know, if you want to think about it that way. We will say loading plants or something. And now we have all the plants in here, we're sure, and I'll just do a table. And let's give it some, a head. So the tables can have a T head and a T body, and the head is the header. And I don't know why I like to indent my things properly. We'd say plant, or we'll say plant type or something for one column. Maybe we can just say type, we know we're on the plants table, and we'll have progress. Or planting, and then we'll have another row for some actions you're allowed to take. So maybe that's to like pull up the plant to kind of abort it early, or when it's ready, we'll put a harvest button in that cell, whatever. And then here we need to loop over all the plants. So we'll say for each plant in my plants, we're going to have a row, and the first cell of that row we would do the plants type. And then here we're going to need to do some progress, so I'll do the progress bar later. And then here we'll have some buttons. So again, we want to know, like, when does this plant grow until? So let's go ahead and do something here. We can say, you know, the current time, like given some time, how much has this thing grown? We'll do is the percent, right? From I guess 0 to 100%. So we'll do a number. So this is what I'm getting at. We're going to want an integer that will represent the percent grown as a 0 to 100, right? You could go 0 to 1 and do 0.2 is 20%, which is maybe more mathematically correct. But I feel like for most people, they prefer thinking of 20% as the number 20, not as 0.2. It's just a little easy to reason about. But if you prefer to use a float or a double and do the 0 to 1 thing, you can do that. We will say percent grown, I guess. And I want you to give me some sort of date for when I'm evaluating this from. And I'll talk about why I'm making this particular choice. We're going to call this now. And we want to know, what is the difference between now and when it was planted? And at 8 hours, right, I've said these plants will all take 8 hours. There's ways you could make them take variable amounts of time, but we want, once it's at 8 hours, it's 100%. And when it's at, you know, 0 seconds, that's 0%, and we want to scale in between. So we will do, say, grow time equals the current time minus when it was planted on. So I'll guess the difference, right? If it's currently 8 p.m. and it was planted at noon, 8 minus noon is 8 hours, right? And you might say, oh, interesting, we can subtract dates. What is grow time? Well, grow time is now a time span that represents this amount of time. So let's get from that, actually, let's pull out from that. So this is the time span. Let's get, well, how many hours was that, or days or seconds? Actually, maybe we should go for total. And this is an important thing. So you might say, oh, I want to get days or hours, or seconds, right? You see seconds here and say, cool, I want to do seconds because I want my percent thing to be very precise. But this is actually just the seconds part of, you know, suppose it was actually, it's been 8 hours and 3 minutes and 20 seconds. If you say dot seconds, you're just going to get 20. What you want to make sure is you get total seconds that will turn, you know, however many hours, minutes, and seconds, sum them all up and give you the total amount of seconds. And you can see that it's a double value, which it's got decimal points to it. So it's even giving you the seconds as a decimal component. Whatever. Okay, so this is our total seconds, and let's call it something. So we'll say grow time in seconds. And here's something else we don't want, anything. Just in case, like, what if now is somehow in the past or more likely way past 8 hours, right? Maybe someone comes back in 12 hours. We want to clamp this value between zero, right? Should never be less than zero, but also never more than 8 hours. So what is that in seconds? Would be 8 hours, 60 minutes in a second, or sorry, 60 minutes in an hour, 60 seconds in a minute. So this will, whatever this value is, this total seconds, we're going to make sure with the clamp function, that's just a built-in C# function. You can Google, Microsoft's documented it, etc. Clamp between 0 and 8 hours worth of seconds. Then to get our percent growth, we say, okay, what is that value out of, right? What is the grow time in seconds out of 8 hours, but times 100, because we want it in that kind of natural thinking value. So we will take grow time in seconds, we'll multiply by 100, divide by this. So maybe it's even worth giving that a name. So we'll say 8 hours in seconds. Oops, that's a constant int. So just so we, I don't know, it's a little more readable, and we're going to use the thing twice. So there we go. And this is complaining because it's saying, hey, this is a double. It's got all kinds of decimal parts to it. But you told me this function only does an int. So we'll say, yes, 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 make it an int. And this will just drop off the decimal part. So there you go. Here's 8 hours in seconds. Divide. And you can do this in any order. You could multiply by 100 at the end. That might make more a little more sense depending on how you're thinking about the math. So let's do it that way. There are reasons why I like to multiply first. It really doesn't matter in most contexts. So let's just do it this way. All right, so this will give us the percent grown for any pet given some time. So I want to talk about a thing. Why didn't, because if you've done date stuff before, right, we have UTC now, why not just say, right, why pass this in and not just say now? You could do that. As a general rule, there's various reasons. It's nice to have a function not depend, no matter how many times you call the function, you always get the same result. That's a desirable quality, right? So in this function, if we call percent grown in 3 seconds, we get a different result than current time or 3 seconds ago, right? And that can make some things difficult. It can make testing difficult, can make reusing the function in other contexts difficult. So a really good thing to do is, if possible, say, no, I want to make sure that this function, given the same inputs, always gives me the same outputs. It also helps for caching if you want to cache stuff. Some of those things probably wouldn't come up for this function, but it's a good general rule. If possible, make it so that your function always gives the same output when given the same inputs. It's called a pure function, or idempotent, or idempotent. I never remember how to say that word, but you can Google pure functions. It's related to a concept called functional programming. There are a lot of positive qualities of designing your code that way. So, and date time is a classic example of one that's kind of easy to just say, oh, I'm just gonna use the current time. And then later down the road, you go, oh no, this function can never work in other, I mean, it's not often you need to time travel. That's why people generally think, oh, it's just safe to use the current time. But again, if you wanna test that your functions work, or if you wanna start using them in other contexts, you wanna cache some values, things like that. It's difficult if you're relying on something that changes every time you call, such as the current time. So I'm going to pass in the current time of this function, which seems like a little more work, but again, it'll save you headaches in the future. Maybe this example is kind of weird. This example, it might not come up for a very long time or ever, depending on how you do the game. But it's a good best practice. So let's do it. So here we've got a progress bar. Great. Let's worry about that later. I'll draw the progress bar later, or maybe we'll just, we won't do a progress bar. So we'll say, plant, get the percent grown given the current time. So here we're going to do, where do we want to put this? There's somewhere we could do the current time every time we loop over these. I just won't worry about it. We'll just do date time, offset, UTC now. And then we'll throw a percent at the end. So we'll say, what percent is the plant grown? And then here I was thinking what we'd say is, if the percent grown, based on the current time. This is where I feel like I'm repeating myself. But if it's greater than or equal to 100%, then you're ready to pick the plant. But let's do something. I don't like repeating this logic. Let's not repeat logic, especially when we have to pass in the time and it gets really long. Let's say percent grown equals this, and now we can just use it. There we go. So I only have to worry about all the silly date time stuff once. All right, and then we would show a button here that says harvest. And let's worry about what that looks like later. Let's restart the application. We've done a lot of crazy changes here. Let's see that it's all looking right, that we get some sort of percent. I'm already here. Garden. All right, let me show you now. They're both 2%, apparently. This table looks horrible and ugly. I'm sorry about that. Again, I think making that pretty is just going to have to be beyond the scope of this video. So something else you can do, right? This looks kind of crazy when you run all the stuff together. And some characters at the end, I've kind of talked about this before, will start to break things. If you like to give a little more separation, you can wrap, after the at sign, you can wrap all the code stuff in parentheses, and that helps to give some visual separation with the percent sign rather than this, I feel like, does look kind of, I don't know, right? Where's the variable name begin and end? It's a little harder to tell. I don't know. So that's up to you. It makes no difference code-wise, but if it helps the readability, and in this case, I think it kind of does, you can put parentheses around. Sometimes you have to use parentheses because of not all characters. Like, what if you wanted, I don't know, the letter N? Well, you can't do percent grown. That's not valid, you know, valid code. So sometimes you have to use the parentheses anyway. We don't have to in this case, but anyway, I was just noticing that when I was writing the code that looked kind of hard to read. All right, let's make the harvest button. So we'll say onClick equals, let me do this little thing, do harvest, and we need to know which plant to harvest because we're going to loop over all these plants. So the current plant, that's the plant I want to harvest. And I was also saying maybe you want to be able to pull up these plants if they're not yet, right? Maybe you've changed your mind and you want to destroy the plant. So we'll say, pull up the plant. I'm done with it. Maybe we'll call it delete. I worry that pull up, maybe a player would think that means, if you can think of better words, this is called do delete. Delete the plant. So these are the two actions that we can take on the plant, depending on whether or not the plant is fully grown. So let's go ahead and implement those. And the implementation isn't going to be all there because, again, we don't have inventory in this version of RPG game. If you've followed other videos and seen where we've added money, or a future video perhaps where I'll go into inventory system again, so you don't have to read me and follow along with that. But anyway, right, what is the reward of pulling or harvesting this plant? That's going to be up to you to implement. This video will not show you that part. But deleting, that's super easy, obviously. So anyway, let's stub out these functions, make some little blank functions, even if they don't do anything, just to get this code running. So we're going to have do harvest, which expects a plant, and we'll say do delete, which again expects a plant. And actually, I've kind of talked about this before. It's a little better to pass in the minimum information needed. I talked about a bug that happened. Let's do the ID instead. It just makes things, it'll make things a little more clear. Let's do the ID, because really what we're going to want to do, we want to look up the plant from the database anyway. As I've talked about in other videos, maybe they've got two tabs open of the garden, and in this one they've harvested the apple tree, and then you go back to this one and it's still visible. If you're passing that whole plant object in, right, we'll have that whole plant object even though it's been deleted, you know, once we've got the delete function here. Go back to this other tab, still looks like it's here. So to prevent ourselves as developers from kind of getting confused and thinking, oh, I'm working with a plant that really exists, we just pass in the ID and we re-look up the plant and validate. It's like, oh, that data is still accurate. So rather than passing the whole plant object, I'm just going to plant in the ID, the minimum information needed to uniquely identify this plant, that is the ID. So we'll do that and we'll look up the plant. So let's start with delete because that's much easier to implement. We will need a database connection again, so I'll just copy paste that little doodle, and we'll look up the plant. So we'll say plant equals db plants, and we want first or default async please. So we want a plant where the plant ID equals the plant ID that was given to us. And if we don't find a plant, then we can do something. So we'll say, if plant is null. So I have that alert thing where you can pop up alerts and say, that plant doesn't exist anymore. What's going on? I'm just going to say, hey, load the plants again. Do I have that? Oh, I call it load characters. I never renamed it. So let's rename this to make sense. For reasons just like that, I start typing, go, where's my load plants function? Oh, I didn't call it load plants. I called it something silly. I copy-pasted. All right, so this is always false. First or default. That is certainly not true. You can definitely get a null back. I wonder if it's confused. I didn't await. You got to await those async things, right? I've talked about that before, right? Yes. So anyway, that's why it was confused. Good. Thank you for warning me. IDE. Yes, we need to await this asynchronous thing. We don't know how long it's going to take. All right. Yep. And we'll say, right, if you didn't find the plant, right, that's confusing. Again, not... from the code's point of view, right? Suppose they delete the apple tree over here, they go over here, we say delete, but the apple's already gone. Then from the code's point of view, it's like, I don't know, you passed me something that doesn't exist anymore. Reload. You must be seeing old data. Just reload all the plants. So that's what this code is going to do. But if we did find the plant, we do want to delete it. Now we can delete it. So we say db plants remove the plant that we just found, and then we'll save. So we'll do save changes, async. And we'll also, in this case, reload the plants, because now we know the plant data has changed. So let's load up new plants. I'm really curious to see, like, does this apply changes work? So if I, no, it looks like it's not working. Okay, we're just gonna have to restart it. That's so funny. There was that one time it worked in the beginning of the video. I have not gotten in my brain, when does the hot reload thing work? When it's not. All right, let's try deleting the money tree. Delete, perfect. And let's demonstrate this bug that I was yammering on about. So we go to the garden, right? Got apple in both. I delete here, still shows it here, right? And I'm gonna click delete now. And if we refresh, right, it is deleted. Oops. Okay, but this page still thinks it's here, but the code is gonna say, you tried to delete, I didn't find it, just reload the plants. It might be nice to show an alert to say, hey, I couldn't find that or something, I don't know, to let the player know, because maybe they're confused, maybe they didn't realize they had to open another tab, right? They might not be trying to cheat your game, they might not remember that they've got, yeah, multiple tabs open, multiple windows or whatever. So anyway, might be nice to let them know, but I'll leave that to you to do. So this deletes the plant, wonderful. We would like to harvest it, and the harvest logic is gonna be almost exactly the same, right? We're gonna say we find the plant, the plant is null, well, I don't know what's going on. But then in here, before we remove a plant, we would do something. So we would, you know, give the player the, you know, whatever, the things that they get. You know, for demonstration purposes, for being weird, let's give them a new pet. I don't know. Characters, rather, I should say. Sorry. So let's just make them a new character when they harvest a plant. Does that make sense? No. But we'll go ahead and do it. So we need an image and we need a name. So we know that image can be a little guy. I'm hoping that it auto-spaces that for me. No, sometimes it does. And the name would be, I don't know, plant dude. And we do need to set an owner ID. Again, I made that optional for reasons. I thought maybe there would be these unowned characters in the game, but this one should definitely be owned. So let's go ahead and test that out. That you, when you harvest a plant, you get a pet? I don't know, maybe that's what you do in your game too. So go to garden, let's plant an apple tree, even though apparently, oh. The thing. Okay, that was good to check. So after you plant a tree, we should reload the plant so that we get all the update of what you did. We didn't do that before. Here, all right, garden. All right, plant an apple tree. Wonderful. Okay, but I don't want to make you wait 8 hours. This video is already long enough. We're almost an hour. So let's cheat and skip this up. I'm going to refresh. This is looking at old data. Speaking of things that can be looking at old data. So let's make this planted, I don't know, last 3 months ago. Why not? We'll go extreme and the game shouldn't break, right? We should know that our percent only goes up to 100. Let's reload here. All right, it's capped at 100. That all appears to be working. We have a harvest button. Let's see that that works. Did it work? It worked. We have our plant guy. Again, you would want to say something to the player. You hope you harvested and got whatever you got. And probably it's not a pet, but hey, you can make a pet from harvesting a plant if you want. And we would probably check here, right? Like, where is the garden page? Will we harvest, right? Probably you're going to check and say, well, what's the type? Is the plant type an apple tree? Well, then I give them such and such a reward. Is the plant type a banana tree? Then I give them something else. So you would have something here. If this function starts to get really long, because you've got like 20 freaking plant types, you might want to break this out into another function or do something else like that, but this is how you would get started with a gardening system. Yeah, I mean, interesting. Didn't know that we were going to spend a bunch of time making this nav bar. I apologize. I really want to keep the videos a more approachable length, and we're almost in an hour now. That's a little long, so sorry about that. But here we go. You can have a garden in your game now. Or whatever, right? Garden, it doesn't have to be a garden. Depending on the, you know, the theming of your game, maybe this is like a city that you're building, and maybe you don't delete the plants, right? There's other things you could do here. Rather than deleting the plant when you harvest, you could set the time back. You could say, well, it was planted on now. Where's the date time offset? UTC now. So you could reset the timer and say, yeah, this is a, you know, it's a factory, and every 8 hours it's going to give me some gold. I click it, I get the gold, I reset the planted on time. Maybe you call it something else because factories aren't planted, but you can call it whatever you want, right? So you can tweak the mechanics here and have different effects. Maybe you even display them in a grid to make it look like a city or whatever, right? You can do a lot of things with this kind of mechanic. It doesn't have to be a garden. I probably should have opened by saying that. Maybe I'll put it in the thumbnail or something for the video. But anyway, do with it what you will. That is the point. Make a wonderful game. If you do make a game out of this, I'd love to know. Please let me know in the comments. That would be rad. I will totally check out your game. And if you've got ideas for other videos, also let me know. Or questions, weird things I did that were confusing. You're like, wait, why did Ben do that thing and he didn't explain it? Feel free to ask any questions like that in the description, or sorry, the comments, and I'll let you know. Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.